Welcome, my friends. Today we will be discussing the hypothesis test for two independent population means. By independent, I mean that the observations from the first population have no impact on the observations from the second population. Examples might include data gathered from different schools or from different cities. The goal of the two-sample mean test is to determine if the mean of population 1 is greater than, less than, or different from the mean of population 2. For a left-tailed test, we believe the first population mean is smaller than the second, indicated by a less than sign in the alternative hypothesis, and the p-value will be in the left tail of the distribution. For a right-tailed test, we believe the first population mean is greater than the second, indicated by a greater than sign in the alternative hypothesis, and the p-value is in the right tail of the distribution. For a two-tailed test, we believe there is a difference between the two population means, but we aren't sure which one is larger, indicated by a not equal to sign in the alternative hypothesis, and the p-value is the combined area in both tails. Note that the size of the p-value will vary based on the data, although I've drawn distributions showing relatively small p-values. Now, sometimes you will see an alternative way of writing the null and alternative hypotheses, with mu1 minus mu2 on the left-hand side and 0 on the right. This way is equivalent and is desirable if we might want to replace this 0 with some other number. For example, maybe instead of just thinking that there is a difference between mean 1 and mean 2, we think that mean 1 is larger than mean 2 by at least 10 units. Then we might use this setup for the hypotheses and replace the 0 with a 10. For our purposes, we will be using the first form of the hypotheses and will always assume that the hypothesized difference is equal to 0. Let's talk about the assumptions of the two independent population mean test. Firstly, random samples must be taken from the two independent populations. Secondly, if the distribution of each population is approximately normal, any sample size will work. Otherwise, the sample size from each group must be at least 30. Note that the sample size from group 1 does not need to be the same as the sample size from group 2. Thirdly, if the population standard deviations are known for both populations, which is unlikely, you should use the z-distribution. Otherwise, you should use the t-distribution. As it is so unrealistic to know the population standard deviation, I always use the t-distribution for two independent mean tests, but know that some instructors may have you do the test with the z-distribution. Finally, if the t-distribution is used, which is all the time for me, we must determine whether or not the population standard deviations of the two populations are equal, in which case we will use the pooled t-test, or if they are unequal, in which case we will use the unpooled t-test. So, as you see, there are actually three different options: a z-test, a pooled t-test with equal standard deviations, or an unpooled t-test with different standard deviations. We will only be covering the unpooled t-test in this video, as the z-test carries an unlikely assumption of knowing the population standard deviations, and the pooled t-test is a little bit less commonly used. I would still like to show you the test statistic for all three tests, which we will look to now. Case 1 is the z-test, which should be used when the population standard deviations are known. Here is the test statistic. If you haven't caught on already, values with a subscript 1 correspond to the first sample, and values with a subscript 2 correspond to the second sample. As it is unlikely that the standard deviations will be known, we will not be showing the z-test procedure in this video. Case 2 is the unpooled t-test, which should be used when the population standard deviations are unknown and assumed to be unequal. The test statistic is the same as it was in the z-test, except we substitute s for sigma. The degrees of freedom should technically be calculated using this formula, which is a little bit complicated, but the degrees of freedom can be conservatively estimated by the smaller of n1 minus 1 or n2 minus 1. Case 3 is the pooled t-test, which should be used when the population standard deviations are unknown but assumed to be equal. This can be verified with an additional hypothesis test, which we won't be covering in this video. Here is the test statistic. In order to use this procedure, you must calculate a pooled estimate for the standard deviation using this formula. The degrees of freedom in this case are n1 plus n2 minus 2. Note that sometimes you will see an additional term in the numerator of any of these three formulas, such as minus mu 1 minus mu 2, or perhaps minus delta sub 0. This part is necessary if you are testing a difference other than 0, as we talked about earlier, but for our purposes we do not need this additional term. We will be focusing on the middle case, which is the unpooled t-test, but just know that there are two other approaches that might be appropriate depending on the circumstance. In this video, I will be using the TI-84 calculator pre-built function called two-sample t-test to calculate the test statistic. I am showing you these formulas so you know what the calculator is doing when it gives you a test statistic. Alright, let's look at an example. Do American men weigh more or less than Canadian men on average? A random sample of 49 American men and 64 Canadian men found a mean weight of 198 pounds for the American men with a standard deviation of 25, and a mean weight of 187 pounds for the Canadian men with a standard deviation of 20. Is there sufficient evidence to conclude that there is a difference in the mean weight of American and Canadian men? Use a 0.05 level of significance. Let's begin by listing out some of the given information. We can let sample 1 represent Americans, and sample 2 represent Canadians. N1 is the 49 Americans that were sampled. X bar 1 is the sample mean of 198 for Americans, and S1 is the sample standard deviation for Americans, which is 25. N2 is the 64 Canadians that were sampled. X bar 2 is the sample mean of 187 for Canadians, and S2 is the sample standard deviation for Canadians, which is 20. Next, we can move on to setting up the null and alternative hypotheses. For the difference of two independent population means, the null and alternative hypotheses contain mu1 and mu2 with some symbol in the middle, which we will determine based on the wording in the problem. If we reread the given information, we see the research question is whether or not there is a difference in the mean weight of American and Canadian men. Nowhere in the given information is there a suggestion that the mean of one population is greater or less than the other, so therefore we have a two-tailed test, meaning we need to have not equal to in the alternative hypothesis and equal to in the null hypothesis. Step 2. Calculations. This is where we get to use the TI-84 calculator. Press STAT and arrow twice to the right to get to tests. Scroll down to 2-sample t-test. Note that option 3 is the 2-sample z-test, which you would use if you wanted to conduct the hypothesis test using the z-distribution with known population standard deviations. As mentioned earlier, I don't use the z-test approach, as it is very unlikely for us to know the population standard deviations. Next, press Enter. We were given statistics like X bar, S, and N, so make sure to select Stats if it isn't selected already. You should select Data if you are given actual data in the problem. In that case, you should go to Stat, Edit, and then enter the data into List 1 and List 2, like I have here, and then return to Stat, Tests, and then scroll down to 2-sample t-test again to finish the test. Enter in all the numbers that we copied down earlier. X bar 1 is 198, S1 is 25, and N1 is 49. X bar 2 is 187, S2 is 20, and N2 is 64. Here, the calculator is asking for your alternative hypothesis. Our alternative hypothesis is that mu1 is not equal to mu2, so we select the first option. For my students, we will always choose the unpooled option, which will calculate the second test statistic we looked at earlier, assuming that the standard deviations are not equal. Arrow down to calculate. Press Enter, and we will have the output that we need. The test statistic is 2.52, and the p-value is 0.0134. You could have calculated the test statistic of 2.52 by hand by using this formula, which we looked at earlier, but most people agree that using the calculator function is a little bit easier. The p-value of 0.0134 could be obtained by the use of the tcdf function, which we have looked at in other videos. We can create the graph if we would like to, which would look something like this, with half of the p-value in each tail, as we have a two-tailed test. Step 3. Decision and conclusion. If the p-value is less than or equal to the level of significance alpha, then we reject the null hypothesis. And if the p-value is greater than the level of significance, we will fail to reject the null hypothesis. Like I always like to say, if the p-value is low, the null has to go, and if the p-value is high, the null will fly. In our case, the level of significance is 0.05, and the 0.0134 p-value is less than or equal to the 0.05 level of significance. The p-value is less than or equal to the level of significance, so we reject the null hypothesis. The p-value is low, so the null has to go. Our conclusion is, at the 5% level of significance, there is enough evidence to suggest that there is a difference in the mean weight of American and Canadian men. And we are done! Alright, my friends, that wraps up our discussion of the hypothesis test for two independent population means. We will be exploring many more fun and exciting statistical topics that you won't want to miss, so make sure to check out our other videos.